الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أبو القاسم محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته everyone. Inshallah, Ramadan is going very well for you, and we're almost half, we're a week in, so alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all your deeds in this month, inshallah. Today's lecture is going to be a continuation of last week's topic, which was hanging out with the right people. So before we start though, we would like to recite Dua al-Faraj so that we can send the thawab of this program to our sahib Asif al-Saman, inshallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir raheem. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma kulli waliyika al-hajjat ibn al-hasan. Salawatika alayhi wa ala abaih. في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
So last week we talked about what it means to hang out with the right people. We said it means to have control over who writes on us. We said there were four ways of being able to do this. And the first one was to choose our inner circle carefully. And that's what we talked about last week. Inshallah, today we'll continue and talk about the next three, building on from what we spoke about last week. So the others were putting up barriers between you and other people that you don't want to write on you, how you can write on people without having them write on you, and establishing groups with a common goal. So inshallah today we will be looking at this. So we'll start with putting barriers between you and other people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this barrier already, and it's called hijab. Hijab is very important for us because it allows us, it controls how the world perceives us, but at the same time it also allows us not to be influenced. However, unfortunately, because of, you know, other people misinterpreting what hijab is, people believe that it's a sign of inequality in Islam, but this is truly not the case. In fact, the opposite is true. However, we're not going to delve into the equality side of the hijab, but how hijab can be used as a barrier. We need to understand what hijab is and its different elements. So hijab comes in two forms, the primary hijab and the secondary hijab. The primary hijab's purpose is to help us to purify our perspective of the world and other people. And what it does is it protects the world from our animalistic self. That's its job. The secondary hijab's role is to help us purify the perspectives of others towards us. So it protects us from the animalistic soul of everybody else. So we'll look at these two hijabs separately and how we can use them to put barriers and how we can use them to, inshallah, help us actualize our human soul. For that is the goal of hanging out with the right people. So the primary hijab. When we interact with the world, we usually interact with our five senses. So our primary hijab helps us to restrain our five senses, not in terms of not allowing us to use them, but actually stopping the shaitan from interfering with them. But it also involves one other thing, which is super important because we are social beings, and it is communication, whether that be the spoken or the written form or in social media. It also helps us the primary hijab helps us to protect others from our words or what we're going to say to them. And that's really important because we are writing on other people. So we're going to take each of these senses and communication separately so we can learn how we can put a hijab using these senses. The first one is vision. And the obvious way of putting a barrier in vision, which is recommended to us in the Quran, is to lower your gaze. In Islam, lowering your gaze is not only to stop you from looking at someone of the opposite gender and maybe getting yourself into haram, but it's also to show people respect. It is to humble yourself in front of other people, quite literally. But also, we need to be able to take this role on. So when we lower our gaze in front of other people, it's not just, oh yeah, I don't want to look at you, but I still think I'm better than you. We actually have to take that on, that when you're lowering your gaze, you're showing this person respect because you recognize their potentiality and they can be better than you. You always have to look at it from that perspective. And when you see everybody is better than you, you'll always be lowering your gaze. Except there's one point where we're recommended not to lower our gaze in this metaphorical sense, and it is when we're helping other people. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, never look down on somebody unless you're helping them up. So when we're lowering our gaze and humbling ourselves, what we're doing is we're creating these, we're making everybody else seem higher to us. We're not looking down at them. Okay? The only case when we're allowed to do that is when we're helping them, when we are giving them advice and we are trying to pull them up. So this is one way of establishing this hijab of the eyes. The second way is to avoid looking at haram in general. And this is, you know, very easy to understand or be told, but subtle things we do not do in our daily lives. So for example, I'm pretty sure all of us have seen Disney movies, but what about the kiss scenes in Disney movies? Do we close our eyes when this kiss scene comes? We probably should, because we're not mentally looking at that stuff. However, sometimes, because it's so quick, we do, whether it's accidental or on purpose. Other things may include if a show or a movie is known to have something bad. If we truly want to keep proper hijab, we should be avoiding that movie altogether or this TV series altogether. However, we don't really do that. We're like, oh no, we have control, we'll just skip that scene and then forget to do it when it comes. Another thing is if there's a place of haram, whether it be a bar or a party where you know there'll be alcohol present, then we should just avoid going there altogether. You're probably like, why are we doing that? And the reason is, it affects our form. So anything which affects our form in the hereafter, we should avoid. So it doesn't necessarily mean haram stuff, just things that are ugly. So, because everything we see becomes part of us. We know that because when we sleep and we dream, these forms come back in our mind. And that's because they've become part of us. So if there's something scary or ugly, we should avoid looking at that thing, because we don't want it to become part of us and eventually part of our form in the hereafter. Remember when we talked about, in the plant exile lecture, we talked about how our Aman form our form in the hereafter. Our Aman doesn't necessarily mean actions that we're doing, but it means anything that our senses are doing as well. So anything that we feel or hear or touch or taste or see becomes part of our form in the hereafter. And that's where we really need to be sensitive about what we're exposing ourselves to. If we're exposing ourselves to something which you don't want as part of your form, don't do it. Do not expose yourself to it. If you don't want a goblin to have a leg of a goblin, say, in the hereafter, then don't look at a goblin. simple. It's very simple but very difficult at the same time. So yes, the second sense that we're going to look at is hearing. And the same thing applies to hearing. Avoid hearing things that are haram and will affect your form in the hereafter in a negative way. So what this means is avoid listening to haram music or any music which will affect your form in the hereafter. So even if it's from that minority amount of music which is halal in Islam, but you think it will have a negative effect on you because, for example, it stops you from listening and understanding the Quran, or makes you hate a particular thing, then don't listen to it. Another thing is swearing. Yes, we cannot control what the people around us say, but swearing impacts our form in a very, very negative way. And we're only talking about hearing. Speaking it is way worse, but hearing it also affects us. And so we need to be able to control what we hear. And the same applies to backbiting. But you're probably thinking, how can we control the speech of other people? Everybody is entitled to speech, freedom of speech, right? There is a way, and it's by placing standards. So I'll give you a story, for example, of someone I know who, at school, they used to play down ball at recess, and what happened is that his friends would swear when they'd miss a ball or that kind of thing. So he made a new rule. He's like, okay, do you guys want to do this bit? I'm going to put a new rule into down ball. If you swear, you have to go to the back of the line, so even if they're not out. And his friends agreed. And in that way, he was able to avoid hearing many, many swear words because people are now being conscious of what they're saying around him. So that's one way. But you recognize that these standards aren't, you know, they're not something new. They're probably things that you've already got in place in your own household. Families tend to have these standards put in place, and you just know them as family rules, not as a hijab, which your parents are putting to help you. So for example, some families don't let their kids go to parties. Others don't let them go to sleepovers, and others don't let them swear in the household. And this is because these are to avoid any form of haram in the future. By knowing that, oh, as a child, you can't do these things. Maybe you don't understand why you can't do these things. But if you are told by your parents, you can't go to parties, you can't go to sleepovers, it prevents you from, in the future, being exposed to that stuff, which is haram. Because, I mean, kids' birthday parties at the beginning, they're very innocent, but soon when you grow up, they become less and less innocent. And if you are used to going to birthday parties when you're a child, what is there to stop you from going to a birthday party when you're older, if you don't have a mature mind? This is why your parents put these rules in place. And maybe that's something you want to take on board when you're building your greenhouse in the future, inshallah. Putting these rules is to help protect your family. It is to build the primer hijab when they don't have that ability to do so already. But now that you're growing up and mature, it's your time to put standards for yourself and the people who you're going to interact with. Send an email, like we were told in a workshop once, that if you tell people that this is when you want, this is how you want things run, they respect you more for it because they recognize that you have, or you hold, a esteem for yourself and an esteem for them. And that's a really, really good thing. Something that we're taught to increase your confidence as well. So please take this on board. It's very helpful. The next sense that we're going to look at is feeling or touching. So the obvious one is touching anyone of the opposite gender or someone who can be attracted to you. So yes, it even includes people who may have particular illnesses which could cause them to fall in love with you, even though they're the same gender as you. So avoid contact with them. That's you know, the one that we're told in Islam. But another one that we're told, which isn't very obvious, is any form of inappropriate touching. So what we mean by inappropriate touching is if shaitan has gotten into your mind, into your imagination, and is playing with it and making you perceive something which as something different. A simple example of this for example when you punch a wall because you're angry at someone, what you're doing is that you're imagining that this wall is that particular person and you want to punch them. Now this has become an inappropriate act of touching or an inappropriate form of feeling, because what you're doing is you're manifesting these angry desires, and shaitan is helping you manifest these angry desires in something else. Obviously it's better than actually hitting the person, but it's still bad form. It's still, you're writing on this wall in a negative sense. You don't want to do this. This hijab protects everything from this. And then we're going to look at the senses of smell and taste. The reason that we put these together is because they're very interconnected. I mean, our nose and our mouth are physically connected, but everything that we eat, we also smell first. So this is what we're going to look at. Tasting haram or smelling haram, they both affect our form in the hereafter. Because, for example, if you smelt alcohol, let's say, and you like the smell, you're going to start imagining yourself drinking it and that kind of thing. And eventually, if shaitan is very, very strong, it can lead you to tasting it, perhaps. And that's not very good. And it may not include haram things in terms of they're haram in the Quran, but in terms of overeating or eating when you don't need it, it's all stimulated by these senses. So putting a hijab, meaning refraining yourself from smelling or tasting things which you don't necessarily need to, is better off for you. I mean, a simple example is buying perfume. We always smell the samples first, and sometimes you don't need perfume, but you just go there because, you know, you like smelling the samples. What that does, it gives you this desire of, I want to buy this person perfume because it smells nice. And now you're spending money in a really, in a negative sense, in a sense that doesn't benefit anyone, you're just wasting it. So we can avoid that by putting this hijab on. And the final one, which is in a sense, but also is part of the primary hijab, is communication. And the reason why this is a very important one is because when we communicate, it is our first form, or it is how we write on other people. Okay? So if we, for example, talk behind someone's back, the reality of that action or that communication is like you're eating their dead flesh. If you, for example, were trying to diminish somebody in somebody else's eye, the reality of that action is that you've stabbed them in the back, because now this person has a negative perspective of this other individual. You need to recognize that these actions will have a permanent impact on the person that you've spoken about, even though they're not here. But because what you're doing is you're shaping their environment or changing the shape of the environment that they're in. So what that leads them to do is have despair or depression. And what despair and depression are is forgetting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. When somebody is depressed, they only see how negative the world is around them. And so they're not seeing the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the world. Or it could lead to anger or the want of revenge in somebody else's hands. And what that does is it diminishes the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If someone gets angry and tries to take it out on somebody, they're not letting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala execute his justice. Because if this person did truly do something bad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have his way with him. But if you thought it was bad, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the truth, didn't think it was bad, then what you're doing is you are doing a bad act, and you don't recognize it. So this is what our pen can do to people. So we need to be very careful with how we use our pen. And that's by having control over our communication. I mean, in the Quran, Luqman, the wise, says to his son, if you thought that speech was made of silver, then silence is made of gold. Because someone who is silent understands the meaning of their word, the meaning of their pen, and they will only use it when it is better than silence. That's the state that we need to be with our communication. If someone makes a random comment, but you know, it doesn't matter, then don't respond to it. But if someone has truly made an injustice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you can speak out against it. You need to recognize when you can and cannot use your pen. Insha'Allah, we can do that. Now we'll move on to the secondary hijab. And this hijab is the one where it protects us from the animalistic souls of the world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very clearly puts what this hijab is in the Quran. In Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the believing men, for the believing men, it is to reduce their gaze and guard their privates. That is purer for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what they are doing. And for women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the same surah, in the ayah straight after it, that it is to reduce their gaze, to guard their private parts, and not to decorate themselves or to make their decorations visible, and to wrap or cover their head. That's a lot of their head and chest, sorry. So that's a lot more for the females than the males. So what is the reason for that? So for females, they cover everything except their hands and their face. For men, it's only to cover from the belly buttons up to the knees. And so people, because this is their only interpretation of hijab, they're like, oh, this is really unjust because females have to do way more. But we need to recognize that there's a reason for it. And this reason can come from it comes from our biology. We are biologically different. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at the animal kingdom and see how animals look different, and why they look different, what their hijab looks like, and then compare it to ours, inshallah. So, these two images, can you tell me which one the female is and which one the male is? So yeah, the male is the one with the antlers, and the female is the one without the antlers, so the reindeer and the doe. What about, can you tell the difference between the female and the male? Yes. The male has these beautiful feathers, whereas the female doesn't. And the male is blue and green, and the female's just brown, with a little bit of blue. What about this beautiful dancing spider? Can you tell the difference? Yeah. The male's the one with the beautiful colors, and the female's just the normal spider. So what is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala behind this? Well, to be able to recognize the system, we're going to go back to the plant exile. So remember, the plant's purpose was to grow and to reproduce. Those are the characteristics of the plant exile. And a plant has this ability to do it, correct? It doesn't need to distinguish, and we know this because a plant has both male and female parts. So in blue, they're the male parts of a flower, and in yellow, you have the female parts of the flower. So if a plant was super, super desperate because it wasn't getting pollinated, maybe there weren't enough birds or bees around to do that, it can actually pollinate itself. But that's really bad for the plant because it reduces its, in science they call it genetic diversity. And when you have a lower genetic diversity, it means that your children or your offspring are less likely to survive. So So, in animals and in humans, we don't have that choice of self-pollinization. And the reason for that is because we are more developed beings that this small difference, this lack of being able to, survive, it makes a drastic difference for the species. Because if, say, a animal was able to self-pollinate and just create a copy of itself, then when the original copy dies, when the original dies, the copy dies instantly because they're exposed to the same environment. And if that happens, if everybody's a duplicate of everyone else, one change in the environment will kill everybody. And that can't work for a species. So we don't have that option. We have males and females to prevent that from ever happening. And because of that, there are particular things that people find attractive, say, because of the biology. And so what these things are, for example, physical appearances. Another thing is strength, so that they can protect their next generation, for example. Physical appearances, because they want, their offspring to be the most beautiful, so they're more likely to have more children and keep the generations going. Strength, to be able to protect the generations. Intelligence, so that they know when or not they need to attack or to retreat and hide. Being very intelligent means being able to understand your environment properly, which increases your chance of survival. And power or money. So usually in the animal kingdom you have the top lion, for example, and all the lionesses want to be married to this top lion because they know that he'll be able to protect children because he's in control. Same applies in humans. There are some humans who look for people who have the most money or people who have a high status in society. Maybe they're like the president or something like that, and they look for those people. However, we recognize in Islam that these things don't matter, because these things are, they're purely about making another generation. But in Islam, marriage is not only about that, remember? In Islam, marriage is to find that compatible partner who you can use to be able to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, as a consequence of that, there will be a next generation. But that's not the primary goal of having a husband or a wife or a partner. So we need to recognize that. And what the hijab does, it stops these temptations, these biological temptations that we have, so that we are able to identify these 9 characteristics that the Imam Sadiq alayhi salam described in other people, so that we can put them in our inner circle. Because if we put someone in the inner circle because they look pretty or because they're super smart in science, then they're not going to benefit us in the akhirah. So we need to be conscious of that when we're picking, but also recognize that this hijab that we're wearing stops other people from making that mistake about you. It allows them to treat you based on these characteristics, not based on how beautiful you are or that kind of thing. So it removes our desirable traits. And that's why, for example, women, it's recommended that they have to wear the full hijab, but it's also she can't wear makeup, for example, or have a lot of jewelry on in public. She can in the privacy of her own home, but not outside. And for men, it means they can't show off their wealth as well, so they can't wear silks and golds. So it applies for both of us. And the reason why we have this barrier is because we're not in control of our environment. We don't know what happens in the outside world. The animalistic soul of other people can be super, super strong, and it could lead to you getting in harm's way. This stops that. So when we're outside, with our friends, for example, or our work colleagues, we have these barriers in place because they are not part of our inner circle. And it means that we don't know what they're thinking or what train of thought or what line they follow, which is kind of scary for us because if we're wanting to be part of their world, we don't want them to write on us and manipulate us. And so these forms of hijab, the primary and the secondary hijab, stop us from being manipulated because it makes us prominent in our own sight. It helps us to understand where our goal is and not be distracted by anything else, inshallah. But then there's something else that we need to recognize, and that thing is that even though these people may not, we don't recognize them as a part of our inner circle, they might think that we're in their inner circle. Like, you know, you probably have had this when someone comes up to you and says that you're my only friend, you're the best friend in the entire world. Does that mean we have to ignore these people? Leave them alone because they're not part of our circle? Because, you know, and the thing is, that's not right either. Because in Islam we have a responsibility to help everyone who needs us. If someone thinks that we're their best friend, then we have a responsibility and a duty to be that friend for them. But how do we do this without letting them in our inner circle? And that's the next thing. It's how we write on people without being influenced by them. And the first thing that we need to recognize with this is what we mean by being their friend is dedicating our precious and limited resources to them. And this most important resource that we have in this dunya, which is super limited, is time. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi said to Abu Dharr, Ya Abu Dharr, kun ala umrika ashahhu minka ala dirahimik wa dinar. So what does that mean? Be stingier with your time than your dollars and cents. If we go further, there's a hadith by Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam where he says, try to the best of your ability to split your time into four sections. One for your call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one for your living, one for spending time with your trusted brothers that know your faults and are still dedicated to you internally, and one for doing pleasures that are halal. And the last keeps you able to do the other. So let's put these two hadith together now. So your time is super limited and you should be really stingy of how you use your time. So Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam gives us a solution and he says this is how you should split your time so that you have the most effective life plan which will help you reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be very successful in your akhirah. And what his recommendation is that you split your time into four components. And we don't mean your 24 hours and you should be splitting your 24 hours into this, this, and this. No. The time that you're awake should be split into these components. So as a child, you sleep for more hours, so the time that you're awake would be much less than when you're an adult, which means that the time that you spend on these four components are very different. But also, it doesn't mean that you have to chunk your day into four bits and just do all your ibadat in one bit, do all your livelihood in one bit. No, it means having an even spread throughout the day. But these are the four things that you should be spreading your day over. The first one is your time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the time when you're alone, only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this can be the time when you're doing your salat. This could be the time when you're pondering or doing dhikr. That should be a quarter of your time of day. The second is making a living. So for us, that could be studying, because that in the future will lead to us having a life and having a job and a career. So that should be a quarter of our day. Unfortunately, for me, I can say it takes up more than our day. You know, because you go to uni and then you have all the studying and the homework afterwards. The next is the time with your awliya. This is specified. It's very important that you dedicate a time off your day to speak to them, because they're the people who are going to correct you. So you're telling them, this is what I've done, this is what I've thought, and then they're here to help you balance this out. Give you an opinion, give you advice. You need that every day, so you need time for them. And the last one is to do what you like, so your hobbies. And so Imam al-Kalam alayhi salam says that this is actually the most important, because this is your motivation for everything else. Your hobbies and doing what you like motivates you to do everything else. So do not leave that out of your schedule. So if you're there studying 24/7, not even the imams recommend it. And the reason for that, they're telling you, take some time off for yourself to do the things that you love, because it will keep you motivated to continue with your life. If you don't keep motivation alive, you lose purpose, you lose your love for this life, and you go into the cycle of depression, which we said was super bad for you. Alright, so where do our friends fit in? These friends that aren't our awliya, but we want to help them, we want to be with them. They can fit in two of these sections. The first one is in the making of a living section. So what we're assuming here is these friends are people who are with you at work or at school. And so you can spend your time at work and school with them, because building a bond at school and at work is very important for you to create your social networks on this dunya, so that it helps you in being able to survive in this life. If you don't have a network in this dunya, for example, for being able to make money or for being able to provide resources and that kind of thing, you're going to not survive. Your animalistic soul needs this. So keeping these connections are very good. However, outside work and outside school, you shouldn't be spending time with these people. Don't go out with them. Don't have parties with them. Don't invite them to your house. Have your relationship with them purely in that place, and they will recognize it for it is. But if you, for example, share more common interests than that, for example, you play for the same soccer team, for example, or they got super interested in Islam, for example. We have the case where, for example, a student became so interested in Islam that they converted. Now they're asking you for guidance. Are they now part of your awliya? Well, Democritus has a very nice quote which explains this. Kinship does not make friends, but it makes common interests. So by spending time with them at school or at work, what happens, it builds common interests. And now you can spend more time with them. Why? Because they've become, they have transcended not only from being in your time dedicated for work, but in the time dedicated for doing your hobbies. So if they have common interests with you, like you guys are in the same soccer team, or you like playing video games together, or you like reading the same books and you want to talk about it, or you just like exploring the world, so you go hiking or on adventures with them, now you're spending more time with them, and that's okay. But it doesn't mean that they've become part of your awliya. But you're allowed to give them that more time of the day, because, and you can impart your wisdom on them. And eventually what happens, what they will do is they will start to reveal things. So they're going to let go of their secrets and expose themselves to you, and may consider you their wali, and that's absolutely fine. But you don't have to reciprocate that, okay? So we're going to say that a human is like an onion. We have many, many layers, all right? And so what they have done is they have exposed their core. That's what you do when you have a wali. You expose everything to them. You do not have to reciprocate and expose your core to them. But what you can do is start unpeeling these layers of hijab with them. And we're talking about primary hijab, not secondary hijab here. So for example, these barriers that you've put up, so for example, that you don't talk about them to them about specific subjects, or you try to only be kind to them, and by that avoiding telling them the truth about themselves, for example, you can start to peel these back. And the reason why it's important to peel these back is because It allows you to show them compassion and love, something that they need. It allows you to listen to them, because if you have put barriers against listening, then you're not going to be able to help them. So by removing these barriers of listening, you can now advise them properly. Not just say, like, for example, they're telling you about the situation and it's super bad, and you just give them the advice that they want. No, you can give them proper advice now. So that's super important. Another thing is that you can start to share some ideas and thoughts with them. You don't have to say that this is Islam, but you can start to give them Islamic thoughts and start to provoke their own insight, their own fitrah, and so that they can start thinking. But you don't have to apply this. You don't have to apply everything that they say to you. So sometimes they want to give you advice, but you have these barriers up. You're not revealing all of your layers, so it means you don't have to listen to their advice if it doesn't comply with Islam, of course. You're not spending too much time with them. You're only spending half of the time, all the time. Okay, and you're not changing your ideas for them. And this is the most important one, because some people who infiltrate into our inner circle because we've just let go very quickly, they infiltrate our ideas very quickly and they start to influence what we think and change our opinions. But the most important thing after all of this is you need to go back to the wali and check up with them. Because yes, we have these barriers, but sometimes these barriers, they flop. And so we need to go back to a wali so that they can strengthen our barriers again. They can tell us, because sometimes someone can give us an idea and it can infiltrate, right? And so we start doubting things. We need to be able to have someone to discuss this doubt with. And this is why you need to go back to a wali. So, for example, after you're at school, you've had a long day at school, go back to your parents and tell your parents everything. Let them know everything that you've done at school. Or if you're a parent listening to this, make sure that you check up on your children at school. Don't think of school as something separate and not part of your business. It is part of your business because these are your children. So when you grow up and your kids come back from school, ask them about everything they did in their day. Okay? So inshallah, we can keep that strong and going. And the reason for this is because our awliya, they are our mirrors, they are our reflections. Hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, "And mu'min mar'atu akhihi mu'min." So our awliya, they're our mirrors. So if there's something wrong in us, our awliya are going to identify it or perhaps reflect it. Because if you both don't recognize this as wrong, for example, you're both going to start doing this thing. And someone else is going to come and tell you that, oh, this is wrong. So for example, if you're So if you're looking in the mirror, you can't exactly see your back. So you're going to need something else to see your back, which is another mirror. And this mirror is your wali. And they'll tell you your faults. That's their job and purpose. Okay? And so we have this hadith from Sulaiman alayhi salam, Prophet Sulaiman, which says, "Do not judge someone by anything till you see who he hangs out with. For the person is defined by his persona and the people around him, and they are ascribed to his friends and their relationships." Which means be careful of who you're hanging out with. These people that spend half of your day, you need to make sure that they're not the people that people see you with all the time. The people that you want to be with all the time are who? Your awliya. And they're the people who reflect the 9 attributes of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. And this leads us to our final way, and it is establishing groups with the same goal. So we've now seen that people who think alike, our awliya, they're our mirrors. Have you heard of Archimedes' mirrors? Well, what happened in the siege of, I'm not going to say that word, in the siege, there were ships, and they were attacking the Greek islands, the one that Archimedes was within. And so what he thought of is this ingenious plan to use mirrors to burn the ships. How? They concentrated the light of the sun and used it to burn the ships. And this is exactly what we can do with our awliya. And so our awliya and us, we reflect off each other. It intensifies what we already have. So for example, for all striving towards actualizing our human self, this intensifies if we're in constant communication with them. This is why communities stressed in Islam, because they recognize that strength comes in numbers, but not just in a general sense, but when the strength is true, when they're awliya of one another. However, in our communities, it isn't reflected very well. And the reason is we fall into this trap. This trap that when we're trying to get people to enter our communities, our inner circle, we advertise things. We materialize our programs, or we create competitiveness between different things. We try to remove what our goal is because we're trying to involve people in our group. That's not right. It's not numbers, it's not the quantity of our group that matters, it's the quality of the group. So what we need to do is start super small, like Stitch. He found one person that he connected to, and he stayed with that connection. And sooner or later, it's going to start growing. So if you start with a single sibling, or just your mother, for example, you can start to grow that. It starts to grow to your family, and then your extended family, perhaps, or friends who are very close to the family. And then you can start to grow this group which has the same goal. And by doing that, we can eventually then create an entire network of people doing the same goal. And when Imam Ta'ala, Abdullah Ta'ala Faraj al-Sharif comes, the entire globe will have one goal of actualizing our human soul, inshallah. But we start small and then we grow. And so, how do we do this? So we've talked about the theory behind it, but how do we do this? How do we get people to come and jump on our trampoline? The first thing is by telling them. Actually go to that person and ask them to be that role. Be like, do you want to be with me? This is my goal. Do you share this? If so, this is, how can we apply it? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا حَبَ أَحَدَكُمْ أَخَاهُ فَلْيَخْبُرْ. لِيَقُلْ. So what you should say, إِنِّي أَحُبُّكَ فِي اللَّهِ إِنِّي أَوَدُّكَ فِي اللَّهِ. So the Prophet says, if one of you loves his brother in Islam, let him tell him so and say, I love you through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I love you through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you're probably thinking, wait, these are two repeated statements. What's the difference between hub and wed? We're going to look at it now. So hub and wed, they're two different words, but they're very similar. Hub is the feeling of love, okay? Whereas wed is the application of that love, as how you act upon that love. So hub is the prerequisite of wed. And we need to, if we have a wedi, we need to both have love for them, which is in our heart, the feeling, and to physically apply that love for them. And it's by reciprocating and becoming their wedi. Alright? And what this means, is that you're dedicating yourself to someone. And that means that you're committing to them. So the second thing when it comes to commitment is keeping in touch with them. Fortunately, with coronavirus, it's more difficult. You can't actually see someone face to face. It means call them, talk to them on a daily basis. You have a quarter of your day dedicated to this. So keep your communication lines open. And because the reason is that we are in this so that we can help each other on the right path. If one person scoots over, the other draws them back. Now, to summarize all these four components in one, of how we can use hanging out with the right people to benefit us in actualizing our human soul, we've made it into a set of steps. Mm-hmm. The first is pick the people who will help you reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make a list of these people that you have seen in your life and you want them to be in your circle. Second, dedicate yourself to them. It means accept that you're going to take on a responsibility for them. Okay? That's number two. Number three, tell them that you want to be with them. So actually tell them, I want you to be my wedding. Number four, contact them frequently and keep account of your goals together. So set out a set of goals with one another and make sure that you're keeping track of each other and accounts and being accountable for one another, because now you're responsible for them. Hanging out with the right people means that you're not only responsible of yourself, but you're responsible for other people. Next one is to place appropriate barriers between you and other people who are not on this list of yours. And the next step is adorn your hijab. Love your hijab and keep it up everywhere. Try to be as strict as yourself, as strict with yourself as possible, because the stricter you are, the better the results are going to be, and the more people will respect you for it. And the second to last one is be beneficial to those who consider you as friends, but don't be influenced by them if they are not in your list of on the list of hoodies that you have. And the last one is be stingy with your time. So people who are outside your awliya and outside this zone where they're your friends but they're not your awliya, but you have a responsibility towards them, then be stingy with your time. So inshallah we can apply this in our life, and this is the end of the lecture. So salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And today's clip we picked is from a Barbie movie. So this movie is called Barbie Fairytopia and the Magic of the Rainbow. Yes, I know you wouldn't think that there's anything in a Barbie movie, but we can find gems everywhere, even as something as silly as this, let's say. But inshallah, we'll show you the clip and then we'll discuss how this relates to us.
Did you really think I'd save your people? Watch as I destroy your precious first blush of spring. Thank you.
context of this clip isn't that important because, but what's happening is that there's this evil person and she's trying to destroy the hope of all of Fairytopia, which is kind of this magical land that they all live in. So this girl is like, no, 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 I'm going to stand up against evil. And I don't want all the potential that this one rose can give to die out. So she stands in front of it, but she's not strong enough on her own to defeat the evil. So she then, and her friends, they're all around her, and they're like, oh no, what can we do? And they're like worried about her, but then she's like, I have to ask them for help. So she tells them, I need you. And then once she tells them, they're like, okay, now we can collect together and help her out. And so the orange fairy, she says, we're not going to come one at a time. They're all going to be there together and helping her. And they all give her part of their power and strength so that she can combine it and then use it against the evil Laverna and destroy her. So how we can apply that in our life is that we have so many shayateen of insanjin in our life, and they're trying to kill as much of the potential in this dunya for good as possible, right? They want to make us fall under their trap. And so what we can do to avoid this is actually stand up against it. And we don't have to stand up against it verbally or physically, but in ourselves. But sometimes we can't even do that on our own because the shaitan is very great. Our desires have been infiltrated by the shaitan. And in these cases, we do need the help of someone else to help us control this. And so we need to ask our awliya for help. And when they come to help us, they will give us that additional strength so that we can evolve as she did and continue to reach, to move towards our goal of actualizing our human self, inshallah. And at the same time, we'll help them as well. So this clip only shows the one side, but the truth is that we're also helping them by reflecting our own abilities and our compassion and ability to become a wadi to them as well, inshallah. So that's the end for today, inshallah. We've just finished the four steps of actualization, and this is a very good month to actually start looking at how we can apply these in our lives so that we can continue with it for ever until we actualize our human soul, inshallah. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.